This is the solution for the problem of Evans, chapter 5, problem 7. It's a little bit involved. It's going to take a little while, but I'm trying to keep this video under 15 minutes. As the question sets out, problem 7, it describes the roulette wheel. We'll take a look over here and just take a look at what that's all about. And then the question asks us about certain particular bets that can be placed that we're going to be asked to actually calculate the odds on. Okay, so you have a roulette wheel like this, has 36 numbers that end up in black and red pockets, and you have two other pockets in green that are 0 and double 0 here. Okay, so that's the roulette wheel. They spin the ball around the edge and it drops into a pocket when it runs out of speed. Okay, so that's the basic idea. This is the table where you place bets. There's a number of ways to place the bets, but just to take a look at the table to begin with is the numbers of the roulette wheel are laid out. Here's your 0, double 0, and then 1, 2, 3 by row. It just keeps winding down here all the way down to 36. So with a range of 36, keep in mind that you have three ranges of 12. You have your first 12, 1 through 12. You have a second 12, 13 through 24 numbers. And the third 12 would be the 25 through 36. Okay. Now you can place a bet on the table. I'll spin it around here. You can place a bet on that first 12. You can pick numbers 1 through 12, 13 through 24, and 25 through 36. You can bet on half the range, 1 to 18, the lower half, versus the highest part, 19 to 36. You can bet on even or odd. You can bet on red or black. And then there's a number of other types of bets that you can place. Okay, so I'm going to spin this back around again. I'll show you the second view of a table that shows some bets being played. On top of those bets, you can bet on the entire column here and place your chip down here at the bottom. Okay, so you place your chip down here underneath the column you're betting on. Okay, you can bet on four numbers that are all joined by this intersection here. You drop your chip down on any of these intersections and pick those four numbers as a bet. You can put a chip on the line here, the line bet, and you can select these six numbers. You'll win if you land any of these six numbers. You can pick two numbers by putting your chip down between the two numbers like this on the line. Okay, straight up is just betting straight up on just a single number there. Column bet, you can see the chip is down underneath the column that you want to bet on. Let's see, that covers most of what else we need to know about that. Okay, so there are some particular outcomes that the problem's interested in the explanation here. Okay, find the probability of each of these events, the ones described up here. Okay, so let's see what we're talking about. Single bets, you can bet on the five numbers, you can bet on 1 through 18, 19 through 36, first, second, or third group of 12 numbers. We went through that. Payoffs differ for each instance. A three number bet pays such and such. It's giving the not the odds, but the payouts. They're not, odds are not equal to the payouts here. Remember, the house always wins on this, all right? So at the very bottom here, or near the bottom, it says define the following events. They want to know about column 1, column 2, column 3, odd, even, green. And just to keep in mind, the zeros are not included in odds or evens. It's not part of that. They are, stand by themselves. So we don't include the odds of hitting 0 or double 0 in even or odd, but they stand on their own. So the odds of hitting a green, and the first 12 numbers, the second 12 numbers, and the third 12 numbers. Now they've reduced the total set of possibilities to just a few that we're going to take a look at for certain reasons. We want to look at what happens if we put down chips on multiple areas here, because you can drop a chip on a number of different areas while you're betting. You can drop a chip on column 3, but you can also drop another chip down in column 1 and bet column 1 and column 3. And you have to look at the odds and payouts to see if that makes sense. Okay, so that's how we teed up the problem here. So we've lined the problem up here. And I'm going to move them off and just get into the explanation here. Okay, so there's 11 ways to bet on the outcomes. And this is the list of the different kinds of bets that you can make. You can make a 5 bet, which we might not have explained, but here on the 5 bet, you're betting on the 0 and double 0 and the top 3 numbers here, okay? You can bet on a single number. So I just tabulated all the different outcomes that can come, the different kinds of bets that you have, and generally each line represents a different and identical set of odds. So on each line, the types of bets that are placed on here all have the same odds. Okay. So here are the outcomes of interest in problem 7. They want to know about the column 1, a column 2, a column 3, odd, even, green, first, second, third, 12. Okay. This is pretty much straightforward. I'll just show a couple here and then show the rest of them. I'll show you how to do a couple of them. So what would be the column? What's the odds of a column 1? Putting a chip down on column 1, what's the odds of winning? Well, there's 38, a total of 38 numbers, 38 pockets here on the wheel that the ball can fall into. And there, if you go by column, there's 12 numbers in each column, so that's simply going to be 12 up here, 12 divided by 38, and that those are your odds for that, okay? Column 2 and column 3 are going to be the same numbers. And if you look at the bottom of what they're asking for the first 12, second 12, third 12. Those are all the same probabilities also. So that set of outcomes all have the same probability. But what about the probability of an odd or an even number coming up? Well, it's going to be equal odds for odd number coming up or even coming up. There's the same number on the table, same number of those odds and same number of those evens. So if we take a look, how many odds numbers are there? There's 18 of them, okay? Between 1 and 36, 18, divided by the total is 38, and you find your probability is 0.47 or 47%, okay? So the even numbers are going to be is going to have the same odds there. And the green numbers is just simply going to be two possibilities out of 38, and there we've set up, so now we've set up the tables of odds here. The second part of the question, when we bring it back over again here, says find the probability of certain combinatorial outcomes here, okay? What's the probability of a green or an odd? What's the probability of an odd or the first 12? So let's move this out of here. I've tabulated what these combinatorials are that we want to find the probabilities for. So we're going to be using unions and intersections here to figure out combinations of these odds. All right, I'm going to move down a little bit, bring back our drawing here. So the rectangle is the total number is equal to 1. The probability of all the possible outcomes is 1. This outer rectangle represents a total probability of 1 of all the outputs ever happening. For the first one, we're looking at the green and the odd. So there's only two green. Let's put this in order here so that I want to put a relative size here. There's only two green on the entire table, but there's what? There's 18 odd. We want to know what happens if we drop a chip on the greens and a chip for odds. So we'd be dropping one on here and one between the two greens up here. We're betting on both of those things at the same time. So what happens is we're increasing our odds, and probably the payout's going to go down. We're not taking a big risk, so they've calculated payouts, but we're only talking really about the probabilities. And what we want to say is, are these two things mutually exclusive or not? Is getting a green and getting an odd mutually exclusive? And yes, they are exclusive, okay? So you have the smaller probability of it being green is 2 over 38, and the probability of it being odd is 18 over 38, almost 50%, okay? And so there's no overlap. You don't have any condition that satisfies both green and odd. They're mutually exclusive. So these are mutually exclusive. That's a mutually exclusive event. And when you do that, you want to know the odds. You just add the odds together. So to do that, we'll take a look at adding F26 and F24. F26 is your green. F24 is your odd. You just simply add them together, and it's something a little bit better than 50%. So if you want to kind of win more than lose and play all night, just keep hitting your green and odds. And something to kind of think about is evens have the same outcome, probability of the same outcome. So if you just stick all night with greens and odds, if you keep hitting that bet over and over and over again, more likely than not, by just a slight percent, you're going to win through the evening. They have to look at what the payout is because they're not exactly related mathematically to the odds, and we're not talking about payouts here, we're just talking about odds. I don't get into the payroll or the payouts here. The problem doesn't either. Okay, so the next problem is, what's the probability of hitting an odd or the first 12? So we know we want to kind of add these things together, We're picking odds and we're picking the first 12, but there are some odd numbers in the first 12. So what we'll do is make a just relatively larger. The probability of odd is 18 over 36, and the probability of the first 12 is 12 over 38. I might have misspoken there. It was 18. Odd is 18 over 36. 38. 18 over 38, and the odds of the first 12 are 12 over 38, and there's some overlap there. So all the odd numbers within the first 12 are common to both of them. Okay, so we have to remember to do something here, right? So if they were mutually exclusive, like the first part, we just add them together. There was no overlap. But in this case, what ends up happening is if we take all of A and add all of B, you're adding this common area twice. And the total probability is really just this irregular perimeter of the two outcomes here, okay? So we really just want the area inside all this, and we'd end up counting this twice if we took A and added B to it, the probability of A plus the probability of B, okay? So in that case, to show you why the equation works the way it does, is we take the probability of A plus the probability of B, and we subtract the intersection. We have to subtract one copy of what's inside this area here, okay? Because we have two. We have one contributed from A and one contributed from B. So we have to subtract out the intersection, which is an AND function, okay? And so what we take a look at now is we're going to end up adding at probability of A, probability of B, subtracting the intersection. So let's calculate the intersection here. And that we do here where we say, what's the intersection O of odd and the first 12? And that is going to be 6 of the 12 numbers over 38. We have to, within this area, we know now that this is 6 over 38. Okay, so we have to subtract one instance of that out. And so if we look at the total equation, we just take F24 minus F27. F24 is odd minus first 12. Oh, I'm sorry, add those together. I'm sorry, I misspoke. We add the two numbers together, and then we subtract out the 1 cent of the intersection here. Okay, so we subtract that number out. So you see the minus H33 at the end of the equation up there. And so when we do that, if we place bets on both of them, your odds are 63%, a little better than that. 63% of the time you will hit that. That will actually come out. So now let's take a look at just combining, put chips down on column 1 and column 3. We're betting on column 1, we're betting on column 3. There's no intersection there. They're of equal size for this problem. I just like to make them relatively the same. Okay, they're about the same size. They are exactly the same size, but by drawing, they're the same size, right? There's no intersection, so we're just going to add the probability of C1 to the probability of C3, column 1, column 3. Interestingly enough, when we get that, we come up with this number 63%, which was interesting. That's the same probability as the previous example, but betting a little different way. So if you're going by pure odds and not using your birth date, other kinds of numbers that you want to bet on, you have the same odds of putting chips down on the odd and F12 as it is with C1 and C3. Okay? So that's, you have to read these numbers. The problems are trying to tell you something there. So look at these problems and go, okay, I see that if I'm only looking for odds, I don't have to include all these possibilities here. I'm just going to reduce the set of things I need to bet on. Sounds like a boring way to bet, but maybe a good way to bet. All right. So now we're going to take a look at the intersection of an even and F12. So we've kind of been here before where the even is larger than the set of F12. So there we go. Group A here is that it's even. There's 18 outcomes out of 38 that are even, and the other one is the first 12, which is obviously 12 out of 38. And there's some overlap because there's some evens in here, okay? So there's some evens in the first 12. And how many are there? There's 6 in this area here. There's the overlap is 6 by 38. The probability of hitting an even within the first 12, the intersection of these two areas, there's 6 ways to do that, all the even numbers between 1 and 12. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. There's 8 of, or 6 of them, rather. Okay, so we just calculate that straight up. Since we already did calculate 6 over the 38 up here, I just copied it over here. So what we're saying is the probability of is the same for even or odd. Okay, so anyway, we have 6 by 38. Okay, 6, that's the probability. So you have to like round up to 16% chance if you want evens within the first 12. So if you only want the evens of the first 12, that's how you bet. You put a chip down on the two of them. See, you're telling the dealer what you're betting on there. You're only betting on the first 12, but the even numbers in there. So that's another way to look at how you're betting. Start lining up your strategy, okay? What happens if we said even or first 12, right? Well, we're going to go through that same equation we did before where if we want or, you generally add things when you're when you provide a union of them. You want the union of even and the first 12. So again, we're still teed up to have the same representation here. The larger one is the evens, and the smaller one here is 12. And now we want to know the area within the outer perimeter of this, okay? We want to know the probability in here, okay? And when we do that, you have to watch out, because if you just add them together, you're going to get a mistake here at the intersection point, which we just calculated, which is even and first 12. So all we need to do is add the probability of A, which is even, plus the probability of B, which is the first 12. So the next problem, the next instance is we're looking at even or the first 12. So again, even is a larger set. It has 18 in it. 18 of the 38 possibilities is even, and the first 12 is represented by something a little bit smaller. It's 12 out of 38. And we just want the area within the perimeter of this, okay? And if you just take the probability of A plus the probability of B, you're going to get two times in here. You're going to actually add these two times because these are two subsets overlaying each other, and that's going to make the probability look too high. So what ends up happening is, as you can see here, instead of getting two, we're just simply going to subtract out the intersection here, which is the AND function, okay, where you have the probability of A and B happening. This is the probability of A and B happening in this little wedge here, okay? So we just have to add the two together and subtract out the center. And when we do that, we get F25 plus F27. And 25 is the even plus the F27 is the F12. And we have to subtract out something we already calculated was even and first 12. That's this section here. So we just subtract that out. And if you look at all these fancy things going on, the probabilities are the same. This should come as no shock that it's the same probability if you do odd or F12 versus even versus F12, the first 12. Same odds. Should not be no shock. So you have to look at the numbers, draw the conclusions, and this helps you understand it more than just the simple numbers, be done with it, and close up. You have to take a look at the numbers as to what you're looking at, especially if you're trying to make money. Maybe that's why we use these gambling scenarios, so there's some motivation here. You can go out and actually use this. Okay. So what's the probability that you hit second 12 and the third 12? So what's the intersection there? You have these relative in size to each other. They should be the same. You have the second 12 and the third 12. Okay. So I'm going to try to make them about the same size. And there's no intersection on them, right? So what's the probability of hitting on there? Okay. If you do the combination right, there's no way to bet that. There's just actually no way to bet on that. You're going to come up with zero. There's no way to do, if you bet, what's common from the second 12 to the third 12, there's just no overlap. You have 13 to 24 in one set, you have 25 through 36 in the other set, and there's just zero probability there. Okay? So what if you try to do a bet on, odd or column 2. Okay, so we have to take a look on column 2. Let's bring this guy back out again. Right. So column 2, how many odds are in there? We're doing, we have to watch out for the intersection here. Remember, it's the same kind of example. So what you have to watch out for is in the second column, how many odd are there? There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So there's 6 in the second column. Just like there are 6 odd in the first 12 and 6 even in the first 12, just by taking a single column here, it's actually teaching you roulette a little bit. The way that the table's set up, yes, if you look at the logic of the table, you're going to end up figuring out that, yeah, there's going to be six odd numbers in any column and six even, because there's 12 numbers, okay? All right, so what are the odds that it's odd and column two? So we're going to make them relative to each other size. Odd, there's 18. There's 12 numbers in column two. So relative in size, column two here is the ellipse V, okay? And there is overlap here. It's any odd number in the second column, okay? And we already decided that that was 6 over 38. So to calculate that, we need to add the probability that it's odd plus the probability that it's column 2. We're going to add those to get together, and then we're going to subtract out the intersection here. So again, what we do is we take F22 and F24 up there. So column 2 and the odd numbers, we're taking those probabilities, we're adding them together, and we're subtracting out 6 over 38. And we're going to borrow this number here, which is just simply 6 over 38. Okay, so we had to calculate the intersection space. What's the probability of the intersection space here is actually 15.78, round up to 16%. So it's 16%. So you see some numbers, these bets have the same odds of coming out. So if you're totally dry calculating gambler, what you're going to do is you're going to say that there's a lot of ways of betting that have the same odds. So reduce the set. If you're not having fun and you're not playing people's birthdays and all kinds of things like that, then you can reduce the number of ways to win, and you should stick with them over the evening, because if you start moving back and forth, then the odds change that once you have a success on one of these, the likelihood won't come up for a while. So if you move around from bet to bet, even though they have the same probability, that changes the statistics here, or changes the probability of winning. So if you just want to have a 63% chance of winning, just sit there all night and play, pick one, don't play all of them, just pick one that has that type of odds outcome on there. And that should pretty much wrap it up. And use the diagram, it helps a lot to understand where you're going with any of these problems. And it will roll into problem eight, where I believe that we actually have three overlapping outcomes, and we have to look at the intersections there.